Good morning from Team Banjara.
Shutdown process.
Once more.
Hi, good morning, everyone. Yes, we are live, Ali.
Right. Very good morning. There's this old student of mine whose husband is a very self-made man. He worked very hard. He started, I think, as a door-to-door salesman or something like that. And in 20 years, he rose up to becoming the marketing head of a big organization. That was the first time that he was given that facility of going to any restaurant and eating there on credit card and this and that. He had an unlimited account to take his customers, friends, whoever he wants to. Till that time, he, his wife and his one daughter that they have, whenever they used to go out, they would go to a very small budget hotel or something, some dhaba, some rashmi, somewhere, have some food, snacks, dinner and come back. Now this man got this thing and he said that, you know, since I have this facility and it is unlimited, I want my family to benefit from it. So he told his wife and daughter, now we are going to a star hotel and we are going to the restaurant and we can eat whatever we want. It's on the company credit card. Now his wife is the type of person who doesn't like to go to all these posh areas and, you know, sit in that formal type of place. I think you'll do it later. People keep trickling in. So she said, there are so many nice places, you know, small, small places where you get something special. We go there, we eat, we enjoy. Why go and sit in that thing? And also you have to dress up formally. That was not something that she really liked. But her daughter was very thrilled, you know. She was a teenager. She said, I get to dress up, I don't get to go. So she also told mama that, yeah, we will go and things like that. And then they land up over there. And you know what happens in those type of hotels. Firstly, you know, food is not all that great. That is one. The second thing is that you have to wait half an hour for the food to come. So now you are all dressed up and formally, three of them sitting over there not knowing what to do. And they place the order and the order doesn't come. So what she did was, they have kept those glasses and they've kept that spoon and fork and all those things. So she took one of those forks, you know, and there were two, three glasses. One was empty, one she filled half, one she filled full. And she started doing ting, 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 ting on those three to see how the sound is different. So ting, ting, tung, tung, chung, tung, she started. And the husband blew his top. Husband and daughter, both of them said that, you know, is this the way to behave in a place like this? Now I have a question to you. Do you think she was behaving in a childish manner? Yes. So she was behaving in a childish manner. Think, think, think.
Childlike.
No, my question is very clear. You people don't bring in your philosophy in it.
Yes.
Was she behaving in a childish manner?
Yes,
yes or no?
Yes.
Yes, she was behaving in a childish manner. That is what I want to discuss with you today. What is childish and what is childlike? Now, childish is what we normally refer to as an immature behavior. A behavior where, you know, you don't connect properly to people, you do things which irritate others, and you try to focus on, like, how a child does, what does a childish child do? Wants everything to come to me. I want all the chocolates. I want this green packet. I won't share with my brother. Those are the type of things which, you know, is child. We say that you are grown up. Don't behave like a small child. Don't do all these things. Don't throw tantrums and all these sort of things. So now here was this question that you are being forced by these people to sit prim and proper and idle over there, and they don't serve you food. So if she wants to entertain herself, what else can she do? So she found this very creative thing and she started doing it. Whereas her husband, who blew his top, saying that this is stupid, you can't do that, and what do you mean by doing this, according to me, he was behaving in a childish manner. Why can't you tolerate your wife or whoever you are with enjoying herself over there? You're not disturbing anybody. She was doing it so lightly that none of the other people were being disturbed. Nobody had to turn around and look or listen or anything of that sort. And she was providing an entertainment. Whereas he decided that when you sit in a star hotel, you have to follow their norms. You have to sit like fools waiting for half an hour. Even if the food is ready, they will not serve you to show how great they are, and they will serve you only after so much time. The answer to this came when she continued doing that. She said, you take me to this place and they make me sit for 10, 20, 30 minutes. I am going to entertain myself whether you like it or not. So she continued doing that. The third or fourth place, what happened was, it was a fairly crowded restaurant, and therefore the service was even more late. And when she started doing this, after 2 minutes, suddenly they heard another ting, ting, ting sound. So they turned, and there was somebody sitting on another table who was also doing this ting, ting. Before they realized, there was a third person and a fourth person doing it. And there were half a dozen people in the restaurant now, you know, playing a sort of chorus, trying to match each other's sur tal or whatever you call it, to see the thing. And everybody's time went off so beautifully waiting for the food, instead of getting irritated and saying, look at this, they're still not served, we are waiting, and this and that. They were entertained so well that they managed to wait. And that is when she turned around and she said, see, you are getting so angry. There are people who actually appreciate me, and I connect to people, and people started smiling at each other. Then they even were talking, yeah, this sabzi is very good, what did you order, what did I order? They became like one family gathering. So that's what I'm saying, that sometimes we tend to take ourselves too seriously. We, you know, think that, okay, I'm an adult. And unfortunately, we do it with children. We force the children to act your age, they say. And Dennis the Menace says that I don't know how to act my age. Nobody taught me that a 6-year-old has to behave like this, a 4-year-old has to behave like that. Which textbook is it written down in? So when you say act your age, what exactly is the meaning of act your age? And more so when you grow up. 5-year, 10-year, 15-year-olds, I can still understand. But when you are grown up, what is this thing called act your age? What is a 20-year-old supposed to behave? What is a 60-year-old supposed to behave, or something of that sort? Right down to a simple thing like, you know, you see a young couple somewhere in a public place who are holding hands and smiling at each other, or looking, and everybody says, hey, how cute, they are in love. Now, supposing that is being done by a 70-year-old couple, how do people react to that? Look at these shameless people, what do they think they are? When you act your age, how can you do it? If it is a couple who are in love with each other, regardless of their age, and they want to express their affection to each other, how is it disturbing anybody? That is what I want you to understand, how we start taking ourselves very seriously the moment we, you know, start coming to that age. It is drilled into us whether we like it or not. Not. We are made to believe that when you are 5, when you are 10, when you are 15, when you are 50, you should start behaving in a particular manner, which is not actually true, which actually destroys your life. The more you can remain, you know, young at heart, it actually affects your life, your health, your physical health. Forget about your mental health, your physical health gets affected by it. If you want to go into the theory part of it, you know that Sigmund Freud came out with that id, ego, superego. So he says that, you know, a baby starts with the id part of it. That is, the whole world should revolve around me. I am the most important person, and this and that. And then comes the ego, where you try to become mature, and then you say that, you know, I am this, I deserve this, this is what I should get. And then the superego says that, no, you have to take care of others' needs also, and things like that. The same thing in a different manner is, you know, given to you in this transactional analysis PA, which says that we are, you know, oscillating between the child, adult and parent stage. So there are times when I'm behaving like a child, there are times when I'm behaving like an adult, and there are times when I'm behaving like a parent. What does that mean? In very simple terms, you know, if somebody drinks you know, some soft drink or some biscuit or something, and I wanted one particular thing and I'm not getting that, I said, no, I want that, you don't take it, I like only that brand or that flavor and I want this. So what am I doing? I am in my child state. People who whine, you know, nobody cares for me, nobody loves me. See, there may be a homemaker who will say, I do so much for my family, but you know, they don't care for me and they don't really appreciate whatever I do. So what is she doing? She's going into that child state. She's behaving not like childlike, but childish. Now, if you are doing something for your family and your family is not appreciating it, whose fault is it? It is my fault. Who asked me to do it? And even if they've asked me to do it, just because they asked me, I don't have to do it. It's like, you know, I'm asking you, give me 10,000 rupees. And you're crying saying, see, he's taking away my 10,000 rupees. He's asking me for 10,000 rupees. Or what will I do if I give away 10,000? All you have to do is to turn around and say, sorry, I won't give it to you. Or I can share 1,000 and not 10,000. I can lend you 1,000 rupees so that I won't get affected. I don't do that. But I continue to crib or complain. Which is what I am saying, that sorry, that is what we refer to as the childish thing. We go into the adult state where we start balancing. And then we go into the parent state where we are trying to control everybody. Look. She is being so childish, she is doing this stupid thing sitting in the restaurant. See, this one is doing that, that one is doing that. So I take responsibility for everybody, not only as a parent, but along with my children, along with everybody else. So we keep oscillating between these. Sometimes one of those three states becomes predominant and then we get stuck in that. So what we need to do primarily is to keep, you know, knocking that off and coming down. So firstly, before I talk about adult life, let me also tell you that we need to help children to be children. One of the worst things that you know, I see happening was this reality shows for children, for example, or even sports. You know, parents who are pushing their child, saying you have to compete, you have to stand first, you have to get this award, you have to get this prize and this and that, and I will give you the best of coaching. I will wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning, take you for that practice, but in the end I want you to get these, that sort of thing. So what are we doing when we are doing this? We are depriving the child of the childhood. A child deserves to have, you know, enjoy childhood. In the crudest level, we talk about child labor and this and that. Children were deprived of school and deprived of play and sent to work. But that, at least that is out of compulsion. The parents are doing that. They are doing it because they are at starvation level. They realize that my salary is not enough, so if my child works, at least we can get some more food on the table. But what about people like us who push these children and make them do things which go against childhood? Imagine a fifth standard child being, you know, admitted into IIT coaching. He doesn't even know what IIT means and what is the whole thing. But fifth standard is 10-year-old. 10 years of age, he is being put that rubber stamp that you have to get into IIT or something. So that is the first thing. Before I move on, I wanted to, you know, be very clear on that. Whenever you are dealing with children in whatever capacity, yes, you have to discipline, you have to make them study, you have to make them do all those things. But do not deprive them of their childhood. And that creates warped adults who do not know how to enjoy, to be childlike and to be able to enjoy the finer things of life. Now what happens when you somebody is not allowed to grow up at their own age, enjoying something? Yeah, studies are there, exam time is there, okay, you stop everything else, you prepare for the exam. some other responsibility there, you have to do that. You know, somebody is not well in the family, so you also have to contribute by taking care of the elders or something of that sort. So we are teaching all that responsibility and everything to the child. But at the same time, we are giving, we should be giving the freedom for the child to enjoy, you know, that childhood which is never going to come back. But when we don't do that, most of the adults, you will see, you can actually analyze adults who behave in one of the two extremes. Either they become very, very self-conscious and they, you know, take themselves too seriously. They want to show that I am responsible, I am mature and all that. If this child is not even, instead of getting 90%, if the child is getting 85%, he blows his top and he says that what's wrong with you, why can't you do that? Anything of that sort, discipline, be bad. The person permanently goes into that parent state, takes his or her own role so seriously that, you know, this has to be done, there is no other way out of it. So either a person who has not had a good childhood moves into this extreme or moves into the other extreme. I was deprived of things as a child. Now that I am grown up and I have the independence and I have, you know, nobody controlling me, I will do everything that I want. So the child who was told that you can't even drink, let's say the child liked Pepsi or Coca-Cola, but he was told, no, this is bad for you. Once in a while, at least when we go out on Sunday, no, you are not going to touch this. When he grows up, what does he do? He is not happy with drinking Coke. He wants to have liquor. That rebelliousness, what I was deprived of, now I will do whatever I want. And that's just a very simple example I'm giving you. A person will start wanting anything and everything that he can. And if he's earning money, he will say, I am earning, so I will do what I want. It's my money and it's my life and this. So just to give you an example how, you know, these things affect people if we don't allow the children to do. Now comes the important thing. As adults, we can do a little bit of an audit as to how we have grown up and where do we stand now. So that is one thing which, if you really care for yourself and want to understand and lead a very balanced life where you look at both aspects, you know, the child aspect and the parent aspect and that sort of thing, what you need to do is to do a little bit of an audit and find out how you were throughout your childhood. Maybe you had very strict parents. Maybe you had selective parents. Certain things they will allow you, certain things they don't allow you. Maybe you had parents who had gender discrimination, that you are a girl and, you know, boys can do this but girls can't do this. Maybe you had parents who did everything for you. They didn't allow you to do anything. They were so overprotective that they won't allow you to take the smallest of risk. So they will do everything for you, thinking that I am doing this, but they didn't allow you to learn some basic skills and all that. Regardless of that, if you can do it or not. See, that is one area where I found that people get a little apprehensive. Because they say that if I am going to do this audit and if I am going to evaluate it, I am labeling my parents. My parents gave birth to me, they brought me up. In many cases, they struggled if they were not very rich or very well-to-do and they had to, you know, do a lot of things to bring me to whatever. And today, see, I am a grown-up, I am an adult, and today I am leading a good life and things of that sort. It's primarily because of that. So today, if I were to say, no, I think my parent was too overprotective, or no, I think my parent was too indulgent, or my parent used to compare me to my brother, whatever it is. If I start thinking in those terms, am I not putting them down? No, you are not. Please learn to differentiate between the person and the person's actions. I still love my parents. I still feel that my father is a wonderful person. I love him. He has not only given birth to me, he has brought me up, he has done 100 good things for me. But if there were a few things which he did, consciously or unconsciously, which has affected me today, let me become aware of it. I'm not going to go and fight with him, or I'm not going to put him down or anything of that sort. I'm just going to analyze and say that this is how the parenting that was done to me has affected me.
Very few of us actually have the courage to do that. You don't even have to disclose it to anybody. You can do an internal audit within yourself, and that will help you understand where you stand today. So certain behavior patterns, when people come out with this thing, I am like that only, somehow I can't tolerate this. When I see people, you know, in a party who are laughing, joking, I get very put off. They are laughing, joking. Nobody is forcing you to laugh and joke. Nobody is forcing you to behave the way they do. In fact, nobody is even forcing you to go to that party. Somewhere along the line, you also have to think, no, it is important because it is my company, something. No, nothing is as important as that. You can always decide that, no, I'm not going to be part and parcel of this type of thing. That is what you can do, provided you do this audit and find out where it is. Any of you remember, there was an old, very touching movie called Anand, Rajesh Khanna. Do you recollect that movie? Various other things happened and it was really touching, everything was fine about it. I just want to bring your attention to one aspect, is Rajesh Khanna, the hero, who has got an incurable disease and who knows that he is dying in short while. He develops a type of sense of humor where he just looks at some total stranger and goes up to him and says, "Hey, Murari Lal, kahan the bhaiya tu itne din se, bachpan se kahan gaya tha tu," and this and that. And almost everybody turns around and says, "I'm not Murari Lal," and walks off from there. And Amitabh Bachchan, his friend, is watching him, keeps getting very irritated with him, that why are you doing this stupid thing? So that's again that, you know, fine difference between childlike and childish. And one fine day he meets Johnny Walker and says, "Murari Lal," and that one turns around and says something to him, "Oh Chetan, tum kaise ho," and all that. And Amitabh Bachchan gets angry with him and says, "Ye Chetan nahi hai, ye Anand hai. To main bhi Murari Lal nahi hu, main Isa bhai hu." Now, just think, reflect over it. If you get a chance, just go back, and it's there all over the internet. You can just watch that one small scene. What does it imply to us in general? What is wrong, even at a time when you know that you're dying, you don't have time left? What is wrong in making or trying to make friends with somebody and just walking up to somebody? How do you make friends? If I walk up to somebody and say, "My name is Anand, will you make friends with me?" So maybe this fellow is asking for money or something of that sort. Nobody will entertain you. No. But if this man goes and says something like Murari Lal, and that man says, "Kon Murari Lal," and something, you know, it can, like it happened in this particular case, it can get you a friend or something of that sort. Similarly, when he goes there to that Isabai's drama company, he gets very attracted to the heroine, and he tells Isabai that, "You know, you introduced me," is getting very fascinated. And when they meet, she is talking in Gujarati and he is talking in Indian. Neither of them understand each other's language. So he gets so disappointed, he says, "Okay, you know, what do I do now? I can't do anything about it. Take a koi baat nahi." Then he moves on to... These are the realities of life. Why I mentioned it is because it was such a touching episode of a man who knows he's dying, and yet he can have that sense of humor. You and I don't know when we are going to die, no? You may die tomorrow, you may live up to the way longevity and what you call that transplant of organs is going on, particularly the youngsters. Easily they are going to hit a century. Be prepared for it. 80, 90 years of age, any organ of yours failing, all you have to do is to go to Mantri Mall, find out where is the heart shop, go get this thing, look for it, say, "I don't want Chinese stuff, give me some nice German hearts or something, which color is good and something. If I give you my old heart, how much discount you will give me?" Take it to the surgeon, he will put the replace the heart, and by evening he'll send you home. You're laughing at me, but this is actually around the corner. Around the corner meaning 10, 20, 40 years from now, when you come to that it is highly likely that that's what is going to happen. So now, are you ready for it? If you are 100 years old, if as it is at whatever age, 20, 30, 40, if you are already started thinking, I am too old for this, I should behave my age, I should be mature, I should be this. Can you imagine another 50 years from now how you are going to be? And if you want to know how to be, you know, childlike when you cross 100 and become 102, I recommend highly a movie called 102 Not Born. If you have not seen that, please see it. Amitabh Bachchan is actually 102 years old, and his son, who is 75 years old, behaves like a great grandfather, and the 102 year old behaves in such a childlike manner that it is amazing as an inspiration to see how these things go. But what we do is, even when we come across, let's say we see this movie, we enjoy it thoroughly, we laugh and joke, but we don't connect it to ourselves. Can I be, when I'm 75, will I be a grumpy old man like Rishi Kapoor? Or when I'm 102, will I be a jolly old man like what Amitabh Bachchan portrays? Remember that the choice is ours. The choice is entirely ours, whatever happens. And even a very serious thing in that movie, one of the major issues was that Rishi Kapoor has a son who has migrated to US and doesn't care for him and things like that. So whenever he makes any request to come and see, or your mother is dying, please make a visit or something, he always gives excuses. And his standard phrase is, "Daddy, I hope you understand." So anything and everything he does his own way, and he says, "I hope you understand." And finally, when Amitabh Bachchan spent the whole movie trying to make this fellow understand what is reality, finally he turns around to his son and says, "I don't understand. I will do what I want to do." But as I said, these are dramatized versions of life, but they actually do reflect life. It doesn't happen in such a dramatic way. Of course, it does happen to some people where, you know, you have an earth-shaking event and then you wake up to see. I know, for example, innumerable people who are so upwardly mobile and who take themselves so seriously that the world cannot exist without me. So I am the great boss, I am the great expert, I am the great manager, I am whatever, these sort of thing. So everything revolves around me. If somebody asks him about something.
He wants to ask me how many bees.
Ask.
So how many of you will ask me? So come on, chat. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You want a 5, 6? Ali. Seven of us.
Simple things, you know, you tell them and they say, no, I'm so busy, I have this responsibility, I have that. And they speak a language which, you know, I thought I knew English, but they speak some different type of language. So if I ask them, what do you do? And they say, I work for a multi-billion, multinational, which has got 3 verticals and 7 horizontals, and we do 360 degrees end-to-end, and we are big players and small players and something. So finally, Baba, what is it that you do? I feel like that Three Idiots movie that, you know, can't you talk in common sense and say that I sell some products or I make some software or something of that sort. Speak in English and tell me. They don't want to do that. They take their life so seriously and all those type of things. Anyway, now this goes on and on and on. Then one fine day they have a heart attack or something like that. And they land up in the ICCU. And then doctors tell them that if you continue this lifestyle, finished. Your next heart attack and you are going to pop off. Yeah, 15 days later he has been discharged from hospital. You will see him at 6 o'clock in the morning wearing latest kids shoes and all that and jogging in the park. And you ask this guy, you know, will you come to the party? No, I have stopped attending parties. Okay, we'll have dinner together. No, I have only salad for dinner. I've given up everything and those sort of things. And they bring about this whole change in lifestyle. Now, why do you want to wait till such a thing happens to you and then have a makeup class. In fact, I remember I had met a classmate of mine who had done exceedingly well in her life, and he was somewhere at the top. We happened to bump in, and much later he had shifted to Bangalore. I didn't know that. One fine day we bumped into each other, and I realized that he's also now living in Bangalore. So I started talking to him. At that time, I used to give a talk on the first Friday of every month at 5 o'clock in a place called Institute of World Culture in Basamgudi. His office was not very far from Basamgudi. So I told him, on Friday evening, once in a month, first Friday of the month, 5 o'clock, why don't you drop in there? You know, after the talk, we can sit and have a cup of tea, we can catch up something. I said, 5 o'clock in the evening, I never got out of office here. What are you talking about? I said, it's Friday, TGIF, end of the week. Can't you take off at 5 o'clock? Quarter to 5 also, if you leave office in 10 minutes, you're... no way. Friday is the busiest day, in fact, because weekend is coming, we have to catch up with so much of work. Many a time I have to come back on Saturdays, I have to do this. He gave me one long lecture about how important he is. Few months later, one fine day, when I go there at quarter to five, this man is standing there. I said, how come you managed to leave work so early and come? He said, I got thrown out of my job. We had that, what do they call it? Merger and acquisition, and this multinational took over that multinational, and something happened. And because he was right there at the top, he was one of the first people to get thrown out. So now I'm wondering what to do. I said, you come and do DCS, find life much more useful. Now, these are real life situations, which, as I said, why do we want to wait, you know, till something goes wrong? Why can't we actually go back to being that little child in ourselves, taking ourselves a little more, little less seriously, and say, okay, the world doesn't revolve around me, nothing great is going to happen. And every time I need not put up that show and this and that. I'll give you a classic example which I always keep repeating because it has left a lifelong impact on me. You know how the military is so hierarchy bound and this and that, and everything has to go spick and span as per the ranks and this and that. Now, you imagine a person who has risen up to the top. One fine day, when I had just finished my studies and I was looking after a printing press, one gentleman walked in and he said that, can I get some visiting cards printed? I said, sure. He said that, I'm retired, I just want my name and address and phone number because I moved to a new house. And he said, yeah, you're saying something. And then when he wrote down his name, I.H. Latif, I jumped out of my chair. He had retired as the Air Chief Marshal of the Indian Air Force, the top man of the Indian Air Force. And I looked at him and said, sir, you are the Air Chief Marshal Latif. He said, retired. Now I'm only I.H. Latif. Okay, but don't you want to write that? People who know who I am, I don't have to tell. And people who don't know, why should I go about telling that once upon a time I was the head of the Air Force or something of that sort? It's fine here. Achha, that was wrong. The second thing was, he said that, okay, you're going to be printing my visiting cards. Can I see how visiting cards are printed? I have no idea. I want to learn and observe and see. He actually stood there for 2 hours watching how visiting cards that, how in those days, it was a very cumbersome process, alphabet by alphabet, used to make that, run a proof, get everything done, then load it onto the machine and then run out one piece after another. Throughout that process, he was happily watching there. That tea fellow came and my tea, I made it by two and gave him half a cup of tea, happily drank that. Now, this is what I'm saying, that at that 62 years of age or whatever it was, he was already mentally tuned to whatever it is. He was obviously a very, very super efficient person. That's why he rose up to the top. But he never fooled himself saying that I am so great at this. The feather in the cap was, few days later, I see him on a footpath buying some fruits. So I was going on my bike, I stopped. And I went up to him and I said, sir, you remember? Of course, you printed some beautiful visiting cards for me and this and that.
for that. Then he turned around and said, actually, you know, I unnecessarily troubled you for making, he had paid me for it, obviously. I unnecessarily troubled you for those cards because those cards will not be of use to me. You know, I'm shifting from here and going to Bombay. So this address, this cards will not be of use. I'm going away to Bombay. So I thought, okay, he's shifting to Bombay, retirement, no? 2 days later, I read in the paper, I.S. Latif appointed governor of Maharashtra.
Oh.
I'm shifting to Bombay. Now, isn't that what life should be? You may be a governor, you may be a general, you may be anything, that's not important. What you consider yourself deep down is what is important to you. That is what I want to be able to, you know, understand. Whether you can, that I have been telling you quite often, no, that sense of humor is a barometer of your mental health. Now here again, the moment I say mental health, people can only think of mental illness. Mental illness constitutes a very small part of mental health. 1-2% of people suffer from mental disorder. 95-98% of the people do not suffer from mental disorders. But does that mean that we have perfect mental health? The same way as there may be 2% of people suffering from, let's say, some very horrifying, incurable physical ailments. But does it mean that 95% of the population is perfectly healthy? No. So we say that, you know, I'm getting a little tired nowadays, so I better do some exercise, or I'm putting on weight, or I've been having these headaches or something, so I better do something. Maybe I'm sitting in front of the screen too often, I must do some yoga or something of that sort. So we keep doing that. The same thing we need to do in mental health. And in mental health, how do you find out whether your mental health is good or not? There are no thermometers, barometers, blood pressure apparatus, no diagnostic tools are available. One of the simplest ones is your sense of humor. And sense of humor is not, you know, putting somebody down, cracking non-vegetarian jokes and making people laugh and this and that. Sense of humor is to be able to laugh at yourself. It's amazing whether you can do it or not. The moment you find yourself, taking yourself so seriously that you do not laugh at yourself, you take your life too seriously, there is something definitely going wrong with your mental health. That's the first warning sign. I recollected my brother had a friend, his name was Dr. Srikant Jichkar. He was a medical doctor who had some 7 or 8 university degrees and over 20 diplomas. By the time he was 30, he was a student union leader and all those type of things in Bangalore. He became so successful in politics that at the age of about 30 years, he became the Home Minister of Maharashtra. Perhaps the youngest who had ever occupied that place. And very young at heart, he was a bachelor and this and that. He used to live life like that. He was recounting. We were sitting together, I'd gone with my brother and we were sitting in. So he was recounting one anecdote. He said that, you know, at 1 o'clock in the night, I was returning from a party. I was wearing a t-shirt and jeans and all that. And I was coming from the party when my car had a puncture. And the chutney was not having air in it. So Home Minister of the state. So he had that gunman and driver and all that. There's no mobile phones and all that. So the gunman got down and he said, sir, I will go and make a call somewhere and I will try and get another vehicle for you. The driver said something. Both of them obviously were panicking. The man got out stressed and then he realized that Baikala police station is just around the corner. He said, I can make a call from there. So he just walked. He is telling this himself. So I went and walked and I saw an old head constable happily dozing away. 1 o'clock in the night. So I went and woke him up and I said, I want to use the phone. And that fellow nicely fired me. Kya samajhta hai tu? Kirane ka dukaan hai idhar aake phone karta hai. So he said, nahi, I think you didn't recognize me. Me, Gram Mantri, I am the Home Minister. I looked at him. I want to make a. I'm telling you, I'm the Home Minister. I want to make a
phone call. Huh? Ticket? Night? Phone night.
Then what is wrong?
He says, hey Baga, this is a police station. After 12 o'clock in the night, he said, Gram Mantri, Mukhya Mantri, Pradhan Mantri, Sagre Yatas, Prime Minister, Chief Minister, everybody comes here in the middle of the night. All drunkards like you. Good. And he had such a good laugh at it. He said, I never realized that I will be told that by a head constable of the... He thoroughly enjoyed that anecdote and he kept repeating it to so many people. Now you imagine if you are somebody in authority and that person refuses to recognize and tell, how angry we get, you know, we try to prove that I am the... Sometimes even a security fellow stops you somewhere and we get so upset with him, how dare you stop me, I am so and so, I am... This is what life is all about. Which brings me to one very important point. We talk about this thing called the inner child, right? Today I am not going to delve on that because that's a topic by itself. But all of us have this thing called the inner child. There is in us, whether you like it or not, this inner child which is always wanting to come out. The inner child actually never dies. Till you are alive, it remains with you. The inner child is something like that in which Sigmund Freud said, or that child state that in transactional analysis DA talks about or something. So however serious you are, whatever life has treated you with, there is always this inner child inside you which is wanting to come out. And that is what you may realize, that there are times when suddenly out of the blue you start behaving in a very childlike manner. And that comes out most often when we are with a child. You know, when you are with a child and there is no adult around, then you suddenly realize that I can do whatever I want. In fact, there is this, child psychologist who has written very wisely. He says, imagine a small baby lying in the crib. The baby is looking around and sees mama, papa, some guest, somebody else, so many adults. And they are talking to each other and they are saying, oh, get me a cup of tea or we will go out in the evening or this or that. A nice conversation is going on. Suddenly one of them comes up to this baby and says, ooh, beep, ooh. And then again goes back to talking to her. So that child must be thinking. Every now and then what happens to this person? She was talking very normally. Suddenly she's behaving like a lunatic and coming and saying, I didn't say that I want to be spoken that day. You would talk to me also normally. No, are you feeling hungry? Do you want something? Do you want to go out or do you something? They don't do that. They never talk to me in that way. That is what I meant by that inner child that comes out when you see the baby or something of that sort. Now, you cannot kill the inner child, but if you suppress the inner child, if you put it into a coma and if you don't allow it to come out, things can be really bad. And the more you keep suppressing, the child starts getting, inner child gets so frustrated that at some point of time, the inner child gives up. And says, this person is not going to listen to me, so forget it. And that is when you start complaining against the whole world. You get fed up and say, nobody cares for me, nobody is there for me, nobody does the life treat me so badly. As long as you are nurturing your inner child and allowing your inner child to come out every now and then, you will realize that, you know, whatever bad things happen, there will always be some good things which are happening to you. You can, as I said, enjoy the small things of nature. Certain very small joys and this and that, which, as you know, only children enjoy. Take a simple thing like, let's say a child's school bus. Of course, good old days, you know that once upon a time there used to be schools and there used to be a school bus and all these things. I guess I'm talking about that era. I think we'll have to tell our children, grandchildren that, there used to be an era like that. Anyway, so school bus, drops off a child at this juncture of this road and pushes off. The child has some 200 meters to walk in this lane and the house is there. On an average,
a tired child who's had a full day in school, who's probably also feeling a little hungry or whatever it is, who's got this big, huge bag on his back, how long should it take him to walk 200 meters from the junction to his house? Length of 7-8 houses. 5 minutes? Exactly. So the first thing he does is he will keep watching that school van going, maybe waving out to see if at the back of the window somebody is waving at me or something. Then if he knew that the next bus route also goes past, he will wait there till that other bus comes. He will wave out to some of those people, then he will go away. By the time he will see somebody gets out from an auto rickshaw and they are having a nice argument about how much to pay and all that, he will be standing there happily staring at them. Even if somebody turns around and says, hey, kya kar raha tu ja, he'll just take 2 steps backwards. Again he will be standing and he will be watching stupid adults, you know, they have nothing better to do than to keep on fighting and making the mood off or something. Then he will see one tree and there will be some leaves. He'll try to jump and pluck that leaf. Why? He doesn't know. There's no need for that leaf. But he'll make all the effort to see whether he can pluck a leaf. Finally, he can't do it. But he's not disappointed. He's not upset that, see, I'm so short, I can't do it. And then the classic thing, he sees a stone. And he starts kicking that stone. So he says, let me take this stone home. So he starts kicking it. But when he kicks it, he's not an expert footballer. So the stone doesn't go in this direction, the stone goes off in the other direction. So he follows the stone over there. After he has done all that, he's still somewhere near and his mother comes out and screams at him, what are you doing there? Come get in, I'm waiting for you. I'm so late and I was getting hurried. Now if that mother can come out and start kicking that stone to ensure that it reaches the house, how thrilled that child will become. How many mothers will that, our fathers or whatever, that is what it is. Okay. So let me give you a quick compilation of some of the activities that you can do if you want to be a child. Okay. I started off by making a small list, and Meera and company have added more and more to that. Now I want you to have a look at this list and see whether it makes any sense. How do you show it to the
light?
They can also probably see.
Maybe you can see it. If you want to keep your inner child alive, if you want to keep taking breaks from serious responsibilities, whether you are a student or a homemaker or you are working in an office or whatever you are doing, regardless of all your personal responsibilities, serious stuff, sometimes life gets very serious, somebody at home is not well or you have to take care, there is some financial problem or something like that, so you have to overcome that. Despite all that, what is it that you can do to ensure that you remain, you know, childlike, or you to ensure that you have that ability in you to really enjoy the small joys of life, which do not cost you a single rupee, and they don't even take up your time to the extent that it will. Many a time, this is another thing. I'm too busy to do all these type of things. I refuse to believe that. That's another indicator that you are taking a, you know, life too seriously. So there is no question of your saying I don't have time, because the type of activities that we are showing you or we have compiled hardly take, many of them take 1 minute, 2 minutes, 3 minutes or whatever it is. And if you can't spare that type of time, I think you are wasting your entire life. Signal still processing.
No, but if I am willing to do it at home, but if the people at home are not responding, then I look like a mentor.
That's right. That's what I told another my student's husband, who not only didn't approve, but he used to get very angry with her that, you know, I am chief marketing something something, and I've come here to a 5-star hotel, and you are behaving. If somebody known to me sees my wife doing this, how will it be, and that sort of thing. So you have to face that. That is one thing which you must understand. Whenever you go against the tide of society, family, they are definitely going to put as many. No, your sister. Yeah. Switches are on.
Yeah, switches are on. Just check it out. Just only check that.
No, just start to let me know.
Is that?
The projector is taking itself too seriously. Okay, Meena, you have the...
Yes, I have it.
Read it out.
The signal on.
Get wet in the rain, make paper boats.
Hey, get wet in the rain will catch a cold, and then you will get pneumonia and this and that. And how can you get wet in the rain? That too, in this chilly Bangalore weather. You know, my auntie's mother-in-law got wet in the rain, and then she got COVID, and then she died. That's what stupid things you are talking about.
No,
can you do that?
You can also stroke a cow. Sit on the footpath.
Stroke a cow.
Stroke a cow.
How many of you have the words? There's so many cows you see here and there. Just go and pat it.
The
answers have answers ready.
Yes.
That's what I was
No, but Ali, it is considered lucky, you know, in some
reason. Some people touch
that if you get lashed with the tail.
No.
If you get lashed with the tail,
it's
then
lucky.
Good fortune is going to happen now. Yes. So you make sure that she lashes you.
No problem, Ali. We have lots more.
Yeah.
Eat sugar candy on the road. Wear a funny hat.
Wait, go slow. Eat sugar candy on the road. When everybody is watching and they are seeing that you are 20 years, 40 years, whatever your age is, and not necessarily with a child, because that will be a good excuse. No, my child wanted to eat, so that is why. No. Stand alone or stand with some other riders and happily enjoy that sugar candy till it makes your own face. Pink.
Even a lollipop that sticks
coming
out, right?
Yeah.
Wear a funny hat.
Not funny.
Make faces at a child / adult.
Start with a child and then move on to an adult.
Once when I was traveling in the car, there was an auto and his son or somebody sitting in the car. He had this pistol, and any vehicle was coming, he used to do this, and he was like shooting at them. So there was a scene from behind, this was happening. When I came right here by this window, he did this to me. I put up my hand, he was like, so surprised to get a reaction from me.
Exactly. Or maybe you could have taken out your arm.
No, and even when you, if you happen to come into the city by train, you see the children waving down to you.
Yeah.
And when you don't respond, they get And for these auto rickshaw guys, you know, suppose if you overtake them, or if you go closer to them, hey, the money laid on the side. So for them, what response is going to be?
Kick a stone on the road.
Yeah, that's what I mentioned, just about children do that.
wear a dress that does not fit you.
Oh, with you, to get into it.
All the time, I mean.
Dress childlike, no? Fit into the dress.
No, sometimes you just wear a dress just to have fun with it.
Yes, like, because you like that dress, even if you wore the dress, we like the dress.
Sometimes you just wear it. Like a jacket, for example, that I wore in college. Sometimes I just wear it, doesn't fit.
Something which is faded, something which is torn.
Dance to a kiddie song. Play games that you would play in childhood like hopscotch, book cricket, lock and key, chor police. Read fairy tales. Ask so many questions that it becomes annoying. Don't be afraid to look.
That's what children do. They go on asking you questions all the time.
Try a new hobby every day or every week. Let your imagination run wild. Don't take no for an answer. Be creative, do art again. Run around aimlessly. Fly a kite.
Half the time you're running around aimlessly. You go into the room, you forget for what you went
there. In the office, in the house, you are doing it, do it outside.
Embrace nap time.
Good day.
Be impulsive. You want that ice cream, buy it and enjoy it. But not ice cream, anything.
Publicly. Stand on the road and enjoy that ice cream. Let 100 people watch you.
Especially in orange bar. Then dump also going orange and everything.
Work until you run out of energy. Always smile and laugh as much as you can. Don't take life too seriously all the time.
Yeah, I'm going to go and enjoy myself. You wind up.
Believe you can do whatever you want. Protect your playtime. Put on an outfit that makes you feel happy. Enjoy your own sense of humor by belly laughing on your own jokes and puns. Instead of avoiding puddles, splash through them. Show some physical affection to the people you love. Give them a hug. Sing.
Social distancing.
That's okay. It'll eventually end. The vaccination will come. Sing whenever you want to burst into a song on the streets. That's what you feel like doing. Or even whistle your favorite tune. Eat from a jar. Let's face it, eating a spoonful of Nutella directly from the jar is bliss. Dance whenever you feel like it, in the office, in the kitchen, in your bedroom. Splash in the bath. Apologize without any shame to anyone you have upset. Decide which superpower you could have, if you could have any. Camp in your living room or back garden. Cry out loudly if you are upset or sad. Don't worry about getting dirty. If you see something fun happening, join in. Put yourself first. Talk nonsense sometimes. It's amazing how much fun it can be to just say funny words or sentences. Boast about your achievements. After all, they took hard work, dedication and effort. Just like a child, even if they draw a stroke, it's like, oh, I did. If you are outside, swap walking for a skip, walk or even running. That's so much fun. So that's how there are few activities that you can be childlike.
Awesome. Come, Namira, we'll announce.
Yes.
So we just have a few announcements to make.
Come, Anis.
Sunita,
come here now.
You have to
show to the onliners also. Yeah. So we have a few announcements. Anis has a booklet that she needs to show. Meera wants to talk about Manthan and some more things. We can show it to you. Discover the child in you. So we have a booklet here. If you want some.
Does this have all the list of activities which you just mentioned?
No.
These are
the. Meera, we want to talk about Manthan.
You can come
outside for purchase and if you want to do purchase.
Okay, we have a month-end camp coming up on the 18th, 19th and 20th. The topic is relationships past, present and future.
18th, 19th, 20th of December.
So, we have the pamphlets here. All the details are given. So, Manthan is this very peaceful place in Bangalore, but it doesn't feel like you're in Bangalore. And it's a very enriching and a very blissful experience because you have activities, you have some metathesis happening. And so, we are planning this trip for the entire weekend, but we also have different options. Like, we have the full day Saturday option, okay? And we have the 6 p.m. on Friday to Sunday option. So you can choose whichever one you want.
Yeah,
it's good.
Manthan camps are a lot of fun. In fact, Sunita, why don't you also share some of your experiences with
Manthan? Hi, everyone. So Manthan is like that, the beautiful, blissful green place. There is a nice pond over there with frogs croaking in the night. There is little birds we've not seen in many years. You get up in the morning, you'll hear the chirp, chirp, chirp and you'll get up. And you know in the night that sound, it is like you're right camping. Sorry? No, no, we have proper dormitories over there. With the comforts of bed and bed sheet and everything.
And hot water and
hot water and everything, but still out there in nature.
But the main attraction of Manthan is also the campfire. Yeah. In the night we have a very nice campfire with you know, everyone singing, dancing and even, you know, displaying your talents and everything. It's a very, very peaceful, enriching experience, and especially that campfire where, you know, you just no, like you won't even know that your friend is good at that, and then you know, suddenly that comes out, and you're again childlike also over there.
Yeah, four components of Manthan is one, you get to let yourself loose. Nobody is watching you, nobody is bothering about you. So you do what you want to do. Second, you have talks by Ali,
most
right?
Yeah.
Which happens, two to three talks will be there, which happens at regular intervals. Those are the serious times where you can sit and you can talk and discuss with Ali. That also is optional. You come to Manthan, you don't attend the talk also, we will not force you. Because that is a place where you do what you want to do, right? Third one is activities. Myself,
yes.
Meera, Seema, we'll all be conducting topic-related activities for you to like learn it in a more practical and then fun-filled and enjoyed ways. Fourth is home-cooked food. Very good. We've got a lot of good feedback about food because usually when you go outside and stay, we have that thing, no? We don't like the food in the place. Simple, satisfying food.
Vegetarian food. And you can get your grandma, you can get your children,
yes.
You can get your sister, friend, boyfriend, anybody.
You can bring anybody, bring a gang of people, make it like a picnic. If there are multiple children, we will allocate one of us to handle the children. You know, so that they don't come and disturb you when you are in your session or anything. So we take care of everything for you guys. Feel free to like make this like one picnic with your friends.
Yeah.
Family, early
experience.
Even if you cannot make it through the weekend, at least come on Saturday.
Yeah.
Spend the whole day with us.
Yeah.
You know, it's going to be very enriching and enlightening. And when we do the activities, and after that, when Ali speaks, it's a different kind of mindset. You go back so refreshed, and you would have a better understanding of that entire topic. So it is amazing, and it really changes your life also. It's not like it's there and it's over. And kind of becomes a way of life.
And the friendships we form over there.
Yes,
me and Seema, we became friends. We were two different batches, never seen each other.
True.
But our first month then when we went there, we became friends and we are friends yet. Meera, we are classmates and so we are friends. We see each other every class. But I don't see her in any of the class, only in the first month I met. But till now we are like, you know, we gel. Because of those 2 days, we were such close friends over there. So great place to make new friends and become childlike, you know.
And very like-minded people, that's the best part. And purposely, because of the COVID time, we kept that day thing also, like Saturday morning to Saturday night. Otherwise, if you really want to make full use of that time, please come on Friday and enjoy it till Sunday. That's the best way to enjoy Manthan.
When you say Saturday night, what time
you get over? You're welcome to leave anytime you want to leave.
Generally, dinner is at 8 o'clock. after that is bonfire, people, you know, it's all talent.
See, we have things happening till 12 in the night. But you can leave afternoon 2, evening 4, 6, anytime you feel is comfortable for you to leave.
Yeah.
You're welcome to leave. Nobody needs to take any permissions or anything.
Right.
Come at
an early dinner and leave. Yeah. Exactly, great. 8:30ish, you can leave if you want to really go far.
That happens after dinner. Yeah,
after dinner, before dinner also, normally we switch, you know, put it on. So it'll be nice. Normally 10:30 also if you can afford.
Bonfire time is, there are two things we can do. Either the talent show will be there, people would like to sing and dance or other. Then we, after that, the late nights, what we do is we sit around, we huddle and we talk over the bonfire, which is like a warm, nice way to, you know, you remember the olden days when we used to go for a camp and, you know, sit and talk like that. So heart to heart talk, some Ali will be also there. We all can have a chat. It will be a good experience.
And this is our Banjara Life. Okay, it's a free handout, but it also has very nice articles in it, written by some by Ali, some by our alumni, some by our. So please, you can have a look at this also. And it has all the information of the other details that Banjara has, like the courses, like Seema will speak to you about it. The online courses, the free counseling. So Banjara offers free counseling, any kind of counseling, tele, face-to-face, walk-in, email, any kind of counseling is free at Banjara. So those details also are given in this. So we have Banjara Life as our free handout.
Right, you can even take subscription of Banjara Life. And I just quickly want to tell you, of course, you all are aware of the DCS program, a very popular counseling program. Of course, this year it is closed for admissions. It's open again in the month of June. But we are coming up with online programs this time. Saturday, we are officially starting PGDP, Postgraduate Diploma in Psychotherapies. Ali was just talking about transactional analysis and, you know, the parent, child and you and those things. All that is part of transactional analysis, different type of psychotherapies. And other psychotherapies, and he was mentioning Freud and Skinner, Watson. So we actually, it will be very close to what you do in the master's level. So that is the program. If you are interested in that, that is PGDP online, starting every like 3 Saturdays of a month. Okay, starting now, this Saturday, and it will go on till 1st of May. Right? And the other program is CCAD or CCAD. Certificate in Child and Adolescent Development. So that is completely about the different domains of children, understanding children emotionally, right from the time they're in the mother's womb, right up to their 18 years of age. So that's an excellent program for parents or anybody who wants to work with children and understand their emotional needs. So any of these programs, feel free to call us and we can give you all the details, send out the prospectus, and we'd love to make you all part of them.
Yes.
Sorry.
Yes.
That's also online. CCAD is also online. That's a 4-month program. So there will be a classroom on Monday morning, 10:30 to 12:30, followed by a mentoring session, you know, once a week. So you'll be assigned a mentor and, you know, you can all brainstorm and thrash it out and all that. Discuss with them. Yeah, thrash out the different activities of children, speak to children. A lot of fun. You know, everything in Banjara has a practical angle to it. So these are two wonderful programs which are coming up. Feel free, and even you all feel free to ask us if you want the details.
Psychotherapy
also has a practical angle, which is working on self.
That is
the one. Whatever you will be learning in the classroom, you have to implement it on yourself. So you'll be actually studying yourself. It will be the fieldwork of your study.
I'm my own subject.
You're your own subject. So which is excellent because
you're able to understand how
yes.
you as a client, how you would be taking care of things and how you would react with your problems. So it's easier for you to point it out to your friends.
Correct. Because as a counselor, if you understand yourself well, you can help out your counseling to understand self better. So those are the programs. So see you. We extended our time another 10 minutes. So see you guys. Thank you for joining and please feel free to contact us for free counseling or any of our courses. Take care.
You want more?